You're listening to the DolphinsTalk.com Podcast Network.
You're listening to DolphinsTalk.com Daily, the most listened to daily Miami Dolphins podcast on the internet. Come on, Dolphins fans. Time to fins up.
Miami's got the Dolphins, the greatest football team. We take the ball from goal to goal like no one's ever seen.
Hello, Miami Dolphins fans. How are you today? And thank you for listening to the DolphinsTalk.com podcast on this Sunday night, January the 14th. I am your host, Mike Oliva, flying solo today. As it's the day after, and really it's officially day one of the 2024 season for the Miami Dolphins, as their season came to another horrible, disappointing end on Saturday evening in Kansas City. Myself and Tom Ernest, he broke down that game on the post-game wrap-up show. If you missed it, we dive into everything with that game and the ending of the season, so check that out. But this show is going to be about pretty much Mike McDaniel and why he is the biggest problem right now with this Miami Dolphins team, this Miami Dolphins organization. And I'm going, you know, I spoke about him a lot on the post-game wrap-up show. There's so much more to talk about with McDaniel, as this team's path forward in the next year or so really, really depends on him and if he figures it out or if he doesn't. And I'm going to talk about that on today's show. But before we get to any of that, as always, a big shout out to everyone listening at finheaven.com. Everyone go to finheaven.com, the largest Miami Dolphins message board on the internet. Also, a shout out to our friends at the I Am a Miami Dolphins Fan Facebook group. If you are on Facebook, please be sure you are part of the I Am a Miami Dolphins Fan Facebook group run by the great Carlos Hernandez. And wherever you're listening to this podcast, whether it's Apple Podcasts, Podbean, Spotify, YouTube, Google Play, Audible, Podchaser. We are on all of the platforms. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast wherever you're listening, because even though it's the off season, we know there's going to be a lot of news, a lot of rumors. There might be a coaching shakeup with the staff, not necessarily the head coach. We got the draft. We got free agency. We will have you covered with shows nonstop. It might not be every day like it is in season, but we have you covered in the offseason, when news breaks were there, when there's news, when there's rumors were there, and of course, free agency in the draft with the signings and whoever we select, we are there. So please be sure you are subscribed to the DolphinsTalk.com podcast network wherever you're listening to this podcast. And if you go to our Apple Podcast page, leave us a 5-star rating and write us a positive review. It's got to be positive. I will read it on the air on one of our upcoming shows. So, before we start this, again, I always have to put out the disclaimer because I know people only hear what they want to hear. I am going to be critical on this podcast of Mike McDaniel. I might even throw a few critical comments towards Tua. But again, I'm not calling for Mike McDaniel to be fired. I am not saying Tua won't be back. They are both going to be back in their respective roles for the 2024 season. Should they be? That's a different conversation, but I live in reality here on planet Earth. Mike McDaniel's not getting fired. He will be back. Tua will be back. And I will do a show centered around Tua in the coming days, but on this show, I want to sort of focus in on the captain of the ship, Mike McDaniel, or I should say the captain of the Titanic, Mike McDaniel, after having back-to-back seasons that ended in a collapse. Let's just get that off. I'm not calling for Mike McDaniel to be fired, even though I'm going to be really critical of him here in the next 15 to 20 minutes. So, season fell apart, 9-3 start, and just totally collapsed. And it's not because of injuries. The injuries didn't help, but again, not the reason they blew a 14-point lead in 4 minutes to the Titans. Not the reason they blew a lead in the fourth quarter to the Bills. Not the reason they just looked inept versus the Chiefs Saturday night in the playoffs. The injuries didn't help, but it's not the main reason they lost. And two things can be true at the same time. You know, I can love the Miami Dolphins. I can be a diehard Miami Dolphins fan, but you can be also critical of that team, not be a hater, and also, you know, like point out real flaws and real inconsistencies that are problems here with this organization, specifically with the head coach when things go bad. And folks, right now things are bad in the world of the Miami Dolphins. They're really bad. You don't blow an 8-3 start in 2022. You don't blow a 9-3 start in 2023. Not win a division either time. Not win a playoff game and think, oh, you know what? We're moving in the right direction. No, you're not. You are not moving in the right direction. Things are really, really bad. So, I mean, when you think about the epic collapses in Miami Dolphins history, you know, seasons that just totally fell off the cliff, you know, three come to mind. The 93 season where there was a 7-2 start, then they lost the rest of the game after the Leon Lett game. They just totally collapsed, didn't make the playoffs. That was the year Marino got hurt. I know, but it was still 7-2 start with Marino not there for most of the games. That's an epic collapse. Last year, 8-3 start, then lose 5 of 6, and they had 2 of 4 of those losses of the 5 of the 6 in a row. So you can't say it's, oh, they didn't have their quarterback. No, Tua lost to 4 in a row before he got hurt and didn't return to the field. That's an epic collapse. And then this year, 9-3 start, had them for every game, Tua, and they just don't win the division, don't get a home playoff game, don't win a playoff game, an epic collapse. And this year's is actually, I would rank this number one because the talent on this roster is greater than the talent that was even there last year at 8-3, and that was there in 93 even. Because if you go back and look at this Miami Dolphins team, which came into existence in the late 60s, but I'm going to throw out the 60s, the 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s, 2010s, this 2023 season, to me, is the biggest collapse in Dolphins history. And if you're ranking them, this year's number one, last year's number two, and Mike McDaniel, it's all on his watch. Like, the two biggest collapses in this organization's history is on the watch of Mike McDaniel. Some people think Mike McDaniel is this young, bright offensive mind who is a new age, cutting-edge coach who is sort of changing the way the league works. Some people think that. I think he's an idiot. And I think he stinks at his job. I don't think he could coach a dog to sit down, let alone coach a football team. And I don't say that to be hurtful or rude or even to be funny. I just think he's a bad head coach. Now, here's the thing. Not only do I think he's a bad head coach and he stinks, I think as a play caller, he's even worse. And if that truth hurts people, I'm sorry. I'm not here trolling. I'm not here trying to get under the skin of any fan of the Miami Dolphins. I am a Miami Dolphins fan. I get no joy in saying what I just said. But honestly, the decisions he makes in-game as a head coach, when he goes for it on fourth downs at times, throwing the red challenge, like, they're beyond awful. Like, they're just not, I mean, some of them just make no sense. And, you know, and then just with the play calling, I mean, the big O, Orlando Elzagari, who I wish he had more time in the day to listen to his stuff, but I can't listen to all of it. I caught a few minutes after we got done with myself and Tom with our postgame show, a few minutes of his postgame show. He said, now this is him, he said that Mike McDaniel's the worst play caller he's ever seen in all of his years watching in the NFL, which is rough. I don't think he's that wrong, though. I won't say he's the worst. I say he's the second worst because I once saw Rich Kotite call plays. Rich Kotite was actually worse than Mike McDaniel. But the point is, Mike McDaniel's not good. And, you know, people have compared him to Adam Gase, saying it's Adam Gase 2.0. And honestly, that's a fair comparison. Because the thing with Gase was, he was so knee-deep in his offense that after almost every offensive series, and if there was a TV timeout, he'd run to the bench, sit down by himself, look at his play chart, write stuff down, circle, be writing notes. He wasn't engaged at all with the rest of the team, wasn't engaged at all with the defense. He was so hyper-focused on his offense that he got lost in it. And with Mike McDaniel, he might not run to the bench like Adam Gase does, but after every offensive series, he turns to the guy next to him who hands him the tablet, and he buries his head in the goddamn tablet, and he's ignoring the special teams, he's ignoring the defense. He's a head coach. He must be engaged in all three phases of the game. And as a play caller, I mean, you don't have to be Ron Jaworski locked in the NFL Films offices breaking down tape, you know, 7 days a week, 10 hours a day, to know he has no clue what he's doing. I mean, the play calling, there's no rhyme or reason to it. There's no method to the madness. He doesn't take into account time and situation. He doesn't take into account anything. He's just calling plays. It's literally like watching a kid play a video game. He's calling plays. And the only reason Miami is ranked this year top five in like most offensive quarter in most offensive categories, passing offense, rushing offense, scoring. The only reason is because the general manager put so much talent and so much speed on that offense. And then you factor in how Miami lucked into playing a super soft schedule where the Jets stink twice, the Patriots stink and you play them twice, the Giants stink, the Panthers stink, the Broncos stink. And he was able to sort of, you know, the talent was just able to overcome the poor coaching, the poor play calling, the poor decision making to just, you know, rack up huge numbers in those games. That, you know, the stats look good, but when push came to shove, when you played the quote-unquote real teams, Kansas City twice, the Eagles, the Bills twice, even the Cowboys were the only... Yeah, they won. They scored one offensive touchdown in the game. His offense shit the bed in every one of those games. There is not one game, even the Cowboys game, because they only scored one touchdown, where you can say they lost, but man, his offense played well. Mike McDaniel doesn't know what he's doing. You think I'm being too harsh? Tell me where I'm telling lies. Point out where I'm wrong. Don't tell me about the big days Miami had versus the Panthers and the Patriots and the Broncos and the Jets. No, I don't care about that crap. Tell me when he had a big game this year against a good team where his offense was like, dang, that's a good offensive day versus a good defense. There isn't one. He's a bad NFL head coach. He's a bad play caller who has a fun personality and wins people over. He's the guy in the office at work who always has a witty one-liner, a funny joke that everyone likes to see and hang out with at the coffee machine, who's got a funny story about his weekend, who will, you know, keep things light and keep entertained. But when the serious work needs to get done, he's the guy who never meets the deadline, who's always late, or who always has mistakes with his work. We've all worked with a guy like that at some point in our lives. If you've ever worked in an office setting, he's that guy. And the problem is the Miami Dolphins have a ready now team, a team built to win now, and a head coach who is in so far over his head he's lost. He is clueless, and it's a bad combination. And the issue is the general manager who, you know, hired the last guy in Brian Flores, who couldn't get along with the whole tampering thing, sued the owner, sued the organization. It was a clear whiff by our general manager, Chris Greer. Now, it looks like he's whiffed again on Mike McDaniel, and Greer knows, because once again, nobody's better at self-preservation than Chris Greer. He can't go to the owner and say, this was a mistake, we have to move on, because then the owner's going to say, well, you whiffed on the last guy, you whiffed on this guy, why am I going to let you pick out a third head coach when clearly you can't? Greer and McDaniel are tied at the hip. So there will be no change, even though, honestly, you could probably make a case one needs to be made, but there will be no changes. As I said, Mike McDaniel will be back in 2024 as the head coach. And part of the reason that Miami got Mike McDaniel is part of the reason why they can't move on from him. Stephen Ross's reputation in NFL circles is bad. Nobody wants to work for Stephen Ross. Stephen Ross has a reputation of he fires a head coach too quick. Every 2 to 3 years, he's firing somebody. He's got the tampering thing that, you know, was exposed because they clearly tampered not only with Sean Payton, but with Tom Brady and with Tom Brady twice. There was, if you want to go way back in the time machine, the Jim Harbaugh thing when he had Tony Sperano on a contract and he's out there talking to Harbaugh. That left a bad taste in everyone's mouth because every time there's been a head coach opening, you know, you have to settle for Brian Flores. Again, a guy nobody else wanted, a linebacker's coach for the Patriots that no other team was really interviewing or took seriously. Miami had to settle for him because no big-name coach wants to work for us. And then you move on from Flores and all the drama around that. That's, again, no big-name guy with a good resume wants to work for us. So you have to settle for Mike McDaniel, a guy who got, like, no other interviews with any other team. They're settling for lackluster talent at head coach. And that's the reason why Stephen Ross, even if he wanted to move on from him, can't. because then you just keep yourself in a vicious circle. You keep firing guys, even though it might be warranted. You're not going to get anything any better to come because Stephen Ross is viewed as a clown in a lot of NFL circles for the way he has run this Miami Dolphins organization. So the Dolphins are always the team that has to take a flyer on an unproven guy like Adam Gase, Brian Flores, Mike McDaniel. They don't get the proven guy because nobody wants to work for this owner. So he can't fire McDaniel even if he wanted to. That's kind of what the Carolina Panthers are going through now with their owner, David Tepper. You know, he's a guy who's clearly shown he's unhinged, and he just, you know, hires a guy in March, fires him in October. I mean, he's just hire, fire. The Panthers aren't going to get a big-name guy. That's why the Panthers have to talk like to somebody like Frank Smith, who's a Miami Dolphins offensive coordinator, young, unproven guy, because Frank Smith's going to jump at the first chance anyone offers him a head coaching job. He's not going to look at, well, this is a bad spot, because he has no options. Frank Smith has, so that's why they talk to someone like him. And that's why they're going to hire someone along the lines of a Frank Smith. They're not going to be on Harbaugh because Harbaugh's not going to go work for that clown. They're not going to be in on Bill Belichick because Bill Belichick's not going to go work for that clown. They're not going to be in on a Pete Carroll because if Pete wants to coach anywhere, because Pete's not going to want to work for that clown. They're going to get the unproven guy and hope you get like a scratch off lottery ticket that hits. So that's why I've said for the past, you know, I've been saying this for a few weeks, and everyone sort of jumped on my back, and I think I've converted some people over. I've been saying, you know, pretty much when we lost, you know, gave up 56 to the Ravens, then we blow the game to the Bills. I said the Miami Dolphins have a top five NFL roster and a bottom five NFL head coach. And everyone laughed, said, Mike, you're overreacting. It's a knee-jerk reaction. You're going overboard. Well, you know, I heard that. I looked inward. I go, maybe I did. Am I wrong? And then I went and I looked at every NFL head coach in the league. And I stand by what I said 100%. I can only find right now, I'm not counting the open jobs, because the Patriots, you know, I'm not counting the new coach with the Patriots. He hasn't coached a game yet. He gets a little bit of a honeymoon. I can't count the Panthers don't have a coach. I'm talking about the teams that have established head coaches. I can only find five guys with a weaker resume than Mike McDaniel. They are Robert Saleh with the Jets. He stinks. Shane Steichen with the Colts. I mean, he ain't anything special. I know it was just 1 year, but he's got a weaker resume than McDaniel. I'll give him that. The Arizona Cardinals with Gannon. Again, 1 year, but he ain't showing me nothing. Eberflus with the Bears and Allen with the Saints. Those are five guys that I would lump in with Mike McDaniel as your bottom tier NFL head coaches. Because if you actually take the time to go through the rest of the league, and I'll do it right now, okay, let's go. You got the, well, let's start with the NFC South. Panthers, nobody. Falcons, nobody. Saints, Allen. Todd Bowles won a division. He's been, you know, he at least won a division. He's above of Mike McDaniel. You got the Vikings with their head coach. He won a division. At least he's got that on his resume. You got the Packers coach. I mean, he's won a division. He's won playoff games. Had a big win today versus the Cowboys. You got Campbell with the Lions. He won a division. He is now on the verge of winning this playoff game. It's late, but he's got a small lead as I record. You got the Rams, Sean McVay, won a Super Bowl. You got the 49ers, Shanahan, went to a Super Bowl as a head coach. The Giants, Brian Daboll, won a road playoff game. Sirianni went to a Super Bowl. McCarthy, rough day Sunday. He's got a Super Bowl ring on his resume. He's better. Sean McDermott wins a division every year. Playoff wins. He's better. Nobody else in the East right now because they lost Bill Belichick. Andy Reid, I don't have to say anymore. Sean Payton won a Super Bowl. Raiders don't have a coach. Chargers. Ravens. Harbaugh won a Super Bowl. Stefanski with the Browns. Everything he did this year with all of his injuries. And he's got a playoff win under his belt, too, from a few years ago. He's better. Mike Tomlin, no-brainer. Bengals, their head coach went to a Super Bowl. Texans, Ryan won the division, won a home playoff game this year. I'll get to that later. Peterson, Jaguars won a Super Bowl. It's like taking away the open job, like the Titans, I can't count the Titans. I can't count the Chargers. They don't have anyone in place. But of the established head coaches who have jobs now, Mike McDaniel is one of the bottom five or six NFL head coaches in this league. He has no resume to speak of. He hasn't won a division. He hasn't won a playoff game. And what hurts his case the most is he's got way more talent over all these other coaches at the bottom, Saints, Bears, Cardinals, Colts, Jets. He's got more talent. And you know, nothing to show for it. Now you can say it's only 2 years. If you want to hide behind that excuse, go for it. Again, he took over a team that had a 10-win season and a 9-win season. And he took over back to teams that had back-to-back winning seasons. And then they gave him Tyreek Hill, Bradley Chubb, Jalen Ramsey, and loaded that roster up even more. And he's got nothing to show for it. So as we start looking forward here, because now this season's behind us, what's the issue that Miami is facing to fix this moving forward? And again, they're not firing their head coach. They're not moving on from the quarterback. They are $40 million over the cap. They have a quarterback who will be entering the final year of his rookie contract, who puts up big stats in the regular season against bad teams. But when it comes to clutch, the big moments, he stinks. I mean, that's just putting it nicely. They have two superstars in Chubb and Jalen Phillips who will be coming off major injuries. They're going to play in 2024, but they might not be 100% and be back to full strength truly to 2025. So that's something they're going to have to navigate. The only way for the Dolphins to get better in 2024 is to clean up the sloppy shop they have now. And folks, it's a sloppy shop. Mike McDaniel should give up the play calling. If Frank Smith doesn't leave, give it to him. Give it to the quarterback's coach, Daryl Bevel, who's won a Super Bowl as an offensive coordinator before. One of those two guys should be calling plays next year, not Mike McDaniel. Mike McDaniel needs to be more engaged in the defense and special teams. He needs to stop trying to be everyone's friend and be a coach. He needs to scold players. He needs to even do it sometimes publicly to send a message. He runs a loose clubhouse. It's more like a party each day with a ping pong table. It's always a huge topic of conversation. He needs to be a coach because a lot of the mistakes they make, the, you know, illegal procedures, the motion penalties, the illegal men downfield and offense, those are discipline mistakes. Those are discipline mistakes. That's where your head coach has to come in and crack the whip and not be everyone's friend. And he's got to clean that crap up and find a way to, like I said, crack the whip a little bit. I'm not saying he's got to change who he is. He's got to be himself on some level. He has to be authentic because players will see through a coach who's not authentic. But clearly status quo in his approach of managing a team is not working. The definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. If Mike McDaniel doesn't change his approach, expecting the 2024 season for the Dolphins to end any differently than the 2022 or 2023 season, you're lying to yourself. He needs to tweak his approach. He needs to be a coach. He can't be the nice guy all the time. So I don't know. We'll see. But right now, he is not a good NFL head coach, and he's a worse play caller even. I mean, it makes no sense when you watch these games. It's stuff I pointed out in October. I had people shout me down, say, oh, don't nitpick. Don't be so negative. I'm like, I'm not nitpicking. This really makes no sense what he's doing. And now many other people's eyes have been opened to it. The national media, ESPN, on Sunday morning went in hard on him and the entire coaching staff. Well-deserved. And that's the deal. This offseason is going to be long because really nothing. Mike McDaniel can have the Dolphins next year start 11-0, 12-0. It doesn't matter because he won't be judged till they get to December and January because nobody's going to care how he starts because he started 8-3. He fell apart. 9-3. He fell apart. Like what? You start 10-0 next year. Who gives a crap? Are you going to fall apart when it gets to crunch time, when it gets to the big games late in the year? So nothing Miami does between now and next December 1st really matters. I mean, I know that's tough for some fans to wrap their head around, but it's true. Nothing matters until December 1st next year when we get to crunch time, and we'll see where the Dolphins are then because this is the hole they've dug themselves. And any criticism of the head coach, of the quarterback, and of the organization is fair. So if you want to run to your little Twitter machine and send out mean tweets at, you know, Chris Sims and Mike Florio and, you know, whoever, oh, they don't think the Dolphins are good. You know, why would you? Why would you? They consistently let you down. They've consistently failed in big spots. There's no reason to have faith until they show us otherwise. Okay, two things here to close the show on slightly different topics. Number one, I put up a tweet Sunday evening or Saturday evening after Miami lost saying, you know, the whole Laremy Tunsil trade, which really was the centerpiece of this rebuild with the, you know, haul of picks they got in return from Houston and how they turned those picks into guys like Waddle and, you know, Chubb and everything else. You know, the centerpiece of that of this rebuild that was that Laremy Tunsil trade. And now in 2024, early January, you take a step back and look, you go, well, Houston won the trade. And, you know, most people understood what I was saying, like 90%. But, of course, you get a couple knuckleheads who can't read and don't understand. Well, Houston plays in an easier division. It's not the point, folks. You don't understand. And they go, well, you know, Houston won a playoff game in Tunsil's first year. Yeah, I know. That's my point. So Houston gets Laremy Tunsil, and they win a playoff game right away. They win the division right away. Then they tear the whole thing down, build it back up with a rookie head coach and a rookie quarterback, win the division, and win another playoff game. So Laremy Tunsil's been in Houston, won before they tore it down and won after they tore it down. And in that time period, Miami's won squat. They've won nothing. They've won zip, not a zilch. So, yes, Houston won the trade. If you can't see that, it's like, and they go, well, you know, the AFC South sucks. Yeah, like the past few years, the Jets have been tearing it up, and the Patriots are such a strong team since Tom Brady left. I mean, and the other thing, again, not to harp on it, but it kind of is the point of today's show, Miami 8-3, 2022, 9-3. Like, winning the division was gift-wrapped to them, and they gave it away. So if you can't see that Houston won this trade, and it's not even close that they won the trade, you don't understand football. And if that truth hurts you, sorry, not sorry. If you need to lie to yourself to make yourself feel better so you can accept that, that's a you problem. But there is no doubt anymore that the Houston Texans won that trade because they have C.J. Stroud, who's the real deal quarterback, when Miami still has questions about their quarterback, and they're winning divisions, winning playoff games, advancing to the playoffs. Well, the Dolphins in early January once again are home, can't win the AFC East, can't get a home playoff game, and have nothing to show for this one rebuild where Houston's winning, we'll tear it down, we'll do a rebuild, oh, it's over, we win again. It's like, folks, open your eyes, man. This Dolphins rebuild has failed, and right now it's just a last-ditch effort to salvage this. And as I am recording right now, the Detroit Lions just beat the LA Rams, which now means, as of this moment, the Miami Dolphins have the longest NFL playoff drought win. The Lions had it. With this playoff win, they end their drought, and the Miami, no other team in the NFL has hit a longer stretch without winning a playoff game. The Dolphins now hold that honor. Lions 24, Rams 23, as I report, as I am recording this, the Dolphins now move to the top of the chart, longest playoff win drought. Not something you want to be number one at. Okay, last topic on the show real quick. You know, after the season ends, social media, you know, it's social media. Twitter is a cesspool of this country. It's awful. I mean, it's the worst. And this happens every year like clockwork. And it happens every time there's a bad loss for the Dolphins. And every time the season ends, because it's always a disappointment for the Dolphins, you always see the people on Twitter, well, I'm still a fan. I ain't going anywhere. Yeah, no shit. You know, no shit. Nobody's going anywhere. You know, it's like they have to tell themselves this to make themselves feel better. I'm still a Dolphins fan. And nobody's not a Dolphins fan. I always say, guys will leave their wives, they'll leave their girlfriends, they'll leave their jobs. They won't ever leave their favorite sports teams. You don't have to go publicly with a pledge to pledge your loyalty to the team after the team poops the bed and loses in embarrassing fashion. It's cringeworthy to read. It drives me nuts. It's like here's the deal, folks. Anyone can be a fan any way they want. You want to be a fan where, you know, even after you lose the final three games of the season, you blow a 9-3 start, you don't care. Whatever, I still like this season. I like my coach. My coach makes me laugh. I love my quarterback, blah, blah. Go for it. You can be a fan any way you want. But just understand this. you're part of the problem. Because if you're not pissed off with this team, which you probably should be, and if you're not pissed off that they, you know, lead the NFL with 24 years of a playoff win, and you don't vocalize it, you are letting the organization know, it's okay. Put any crappy product you want on the field. You're never going to lose me. I'll be back. Take my money. Take my money. That's your part of the problem, okay? This organization sees that it can get away with, don't matter what we put on the field, you'll always be back. We're going to raise prices. You know why? You'll be back. You can love your team. You can be critical of your team. You can voice your displeasure of your team when it's bad. And right now, folks, it's bad. Don't be fooled. That doesn't change. You can affect change, is my point. You can affect change. And I know there's, you know, some in this fan base will say, I had fun this season. I don't care that we lost. Or Tua is the best quarterback since Marino. So why everyone coming down on Tua? Great. If that's how you feel, that's fine. But just know, you're part of the problem. Understand you're in the minority right now if you're you know, celebrating this 2023 season, because the vast majority of Miami Dolphins fans are mad as hell and they're pissed. So, you know, have your fun, but the vast majority of fans are sick and tired of being kicked in the nuts at the end of every season. And I often say fans get the teams they deserve. So if you're okay accepting the losing, never winning, the constant disappointment, keep opening up your wallet and supporting that product. The team will keep giving you that product. But if that isn't okay to you, if this isn't acceptable to you, don't be afraid to voice your displeasure. And don't be afraid to speak with your wallet until results change. Because you can affect change with your wallet. You do, as a fan, have a voice, and you can send a message. Because it is utterly mind-blowing that we, in back-to-back years, we blew an 8-3 start and a 9-3 start. And, you know, I'm not okay with that as a fan. That's not acceptable to me. For all the money that, you know, in time I invest, not just with this site, but with, you know, the hats and the jerseys and the t-shirts and the tickets and the this and the that and the that, you know, at some point you want to see a result. And at some point it's okay to tell the organization, I've done my part. I show up, I buy the merchandise, I give the money. I put myself out there and done my part. When are you going to do yours? And for 24 years, they haven't. They've given us moments. Miami Miracle, put up 70 versus the Broncos. They give you moments to enjoy, but there's never a season. There's never a playoff run. There's not even a playoff stinking win, which isn't even that hard to win one playoff game. I mean, again, we're the worst at it 24 years. So, you know, you don't have to pledge your loyalty on social media. It doesn't make you a better fan than anyone else who is pissed off. That's what annoys me. And just know, if you are, you know, I saw one guy today on social, I mean, this is why social media is the worst, who wants to make, you know, loyalty shirts for people to buy the shirts to pledge their loyalty to Tua and the Dolphins. Oh, I mean, come on, really? I mean, I have an analogy here. I'm not going to say it because it'll probably get people enraged, but no, we're not doing that. I mean, if people want to spend their, I mean, come on, really? Folks, this season was rough. It was a rough end. But again, you can love your team and be critical of it and don't be afraid. There is nothing wrong with that. And if you don't, you want to be the happy-go-lucky fan, great. You're a Miami Dolphins fan. Happy to have you as part of the team. But just know you are in the minority right now, I think. And it is what it is. All right, everyone, thank you for listening. We're going to have shows all week. I know myself, Marissa, and the Bearded Fanatic will be back Tuesday. Josh and Aaron will be back Monday. Tom and myself are probably going to do an end-of-season award show at some point, not sure when. Hopefully, probably this week. What else we got? We got myself and Ian on Wednesday, myself and Robert Burns on Thursday. So for this week, we'll kind of like wrap up all the daily shows. And then moving forward, we're still going to have shows. Trust me, we're going to have shows. But it might not be every day because more of when they fire a coach, if they hire a coach, not the head coach, like an assistant, when they make news, if they give someone a new contract, when we'll have shows and we'll have off-season shows too, but it might not be every day. But that's why you got to make sure you're subscribed to DolphinsTalk.com podcast network. So when a new show drops, you are notified on your smart device. Also, please be sure to follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Dolphins Talk and visit the website DolphinsTalk.com. We have a ton of talented writers putting up great work. Everyone, thank you for listening. Have a great Sunday night. Have a great Monday morning. We'll talk to you again after a while. And folks, don't forget, we must put an end to highway profanity.
Thank you for listening to the DolphinsTalk.com podcast. Be sure to visit DolphinsTalk.com every day for all of your latest Miami Dolphins news.